Good morning and welcome to AAI's annual Invitational Symposium. This is our, we love this day. Out of the course of the year and all the conferences and events and roundtables and discussions we have in the antitrust community, this particular event is something we really look forward to and is so very helpful to us. Because it's our multidisciplinary symposium where we get to talk to more than just lawyers and economists. We get to talk to the B-School folks, the strategic management people, the marketing people, folks in psychology, in sociology, sometimes in engineering and the hard sciences, who all bring very valuable perspective to competition issues. And this year, I think, is our 14th or 15th symposium. We've been doing it since 2000. And the topic, as you know and can see, is entrepreneurship and antitrust. And in doing this for so many years, we have accumulated just a tremendous wealth of learning and knowledge and perspective about how the different disciplines can inform competition issues so that we can become better advocates for fair competition and a progressive antitrust policy. So in the past, we've done, I won't list them all, but we've done some really cool stuff. We've looked at systems competition, sort of platform competition issues, trying to expand or expand the lens and in terms of how we look at markets and how we look at competition. We have looked at dynamic pricing issues. We have studied behavioral economics and the role of behavioral economics in antitrust. We have looked at vertical issues, aftermarkets, for example, and just a whole list of really sort of cutting edge frontier topics that we try to get ahead of. That's one sort of goal that we have, and Greg will speak a little bit more to this when he comes up. But we try and get ahead of the curve a little bit on this symposium. So issues that have not yet materialized or developed in practice, either in enforcement or policy, this symposium is designed to sort of pulse or sense in advance. So we're trying to get on top of these things early so that we can think about them. We can come up with some constructive thinking about how they might be woven in to competition enforcement and policy, and I think we do that in this one-day seminar, in this symposium. We also publish all of the papers that come out of these symposia in the Antitrust Bulletin, and I think the last page count was about 3,000 pages that we've published in the Antitrust Bulletin from these annual events. And I would encourage you to go look and see what we've done in the past. And of course, the papers from today will be published in the Antitrust Bulletin as well. So it's an exciting day, and we thank you all for being here, and to our terrific panelists and everybody who has put their energy and lent their expertise in thinking about today. This day is also a bit unusual in that it's been made possible by a grant that AAI received from the Kauffman Foundation. This is part of Kauffman's initiative to look at entrepreneurship through a variety of different perspectives and lenses. AAI, of course, is sort of covering the whole competition angle and the relationship between entrepreneurship and antitrust, which we believe has not really been fleshed out in any coherent form, and we hope to do that. That's one thing that we hope to do coming out of today. So many thanks to the Kauffman Foundation. It was one of our first private foundation grants, and we've just had a great time navigating that process and being part of their bigger query into entrepreneurship. Just logistically speaking, I would note that for those of you who are looking for CLE credit, we have applied to Pennsylvania for CLE credit. That should come through. We will be moving from this room after our two sessions this morning to the First Amendment Lounge for lunch, where we have a fabulous keynote speaker, Anne-Marie Mellum, who is head of the Capital Access Office at the Small Business Administration. So we will hear what SBA and her office are doing on the entrepreneurship front and what some of the challenges are that they see coming from the perspective of public policy and government funding. Other than that, we've had a great year so far in antitrust. If those of you staying for tomorrow will hear me talk about this in a little more detail. After 18 years of advocating for fair competition and a progressive agenda, we hope that we're seeing some of the fruit of our labor. It's been a fabulous year. We've had some really good outcomes in terms of merger challenges and some areas where AI has advocated very articulately and effectively. And I will go through my whole list tomorrow at the event tomorrow. And if you want to talk about it on the side, I'm very happy to discuss how we've done this year and some of these antitrust wins. So with that, I want to turn this over to Greg Gundlach. Greg has been incredibly instrumental in facilitating these symposia over the years. He is one of our directors. He is in the business school at the University of North Florida, has been an integral part of our thinking and our strategy in developing this particular day. And he will be taking it away from here on. Thank you.
While she's setting up, why don't I ask our first panelist to come forward, and that will ease our transition from my remarks to our first couple of speakers. So Mike, Craig, and Stacy. Craig may be coming shortly. He might be out in the hall. Well, thank you, Diana, and good morning to our participants and attendees. As Diana mentioned, this is a particularly interesting day for us and topic, given our focus on the important goal of advancing interdisciplinary discourse, at least advancing a field of antitrust through interdisciplinary discourse. Entrepreneurship, of course, is also of interest to a number of stakeholders outside of antitrust. And one really doesn't have to look far to understand that. Beyond the thousands of entrepreneurs in practice today, there are hundreds and thousands of different centers, institutes, foundations, and what have you, that have as their goal understanding of entrepreneurship and its practice. And with that, I too want to, as Diana has, to acknowledge the support received from the Kauffman Foundation that has made today possible. For my introductory remarks, I'd like to overview our topic and motivate the day by doing three things. First, by describing the different perspectives that are commonly adopted for understanding entrepreneurship. Second, I'd like to frame the types of questions that surface when one begins to think about antitrust from each one of those perspectives. And then third and finally, I'd like to highlight some of the relevant questions that need to be answered before we can determine whether or not antitrust can be helpful to furthering entrepreneurship in our economy. So, as a general matter, entrepreneurship is typically approached from three different perspectives. These include what I would refer to as the three P's of entrepreneurship. And you can see behind me the person. Here I'm thinking about the entrepreneur, the process, these are the entrepreneurial activities, and the place, this is the entrepreneurial organization. Each perspective reflects a slightly different orientation for understanding our topic for the day, and these can be often seen in the definitions of entrepreneurship. For example, entrepreneurship has been defined from the perspective of the entrepreneur to involve one who organizes, manages, and assumes the risks of a business or enterprise. Also, as a phenomenon that comes under the wider aspect of leadership. From the perspective of entrepreneurial process, entrepreneurship is defined as the dynamic process or activities of creating incremental wealth. In addition, a dynamic process of vision, change and creation. Finally, from the perspective of the place, the entrepreneurial organization, entrepreneurship has been defined as a business venture, as an enterprise of any size, as well as from the perspective of the larger ecosystem in which entrepreneurial activity and entrepreneurs reside. For my purposes today, and for our larger purposes for the overall symposia today, the different perspectives offer not only three different vantage points for understanding entrepreneurship, but also a framework for identifying some of the competitive challenges that entrepreneurship faces, and also a mechanism for eliciting questions about how public policy, in particular antitrust, can potentially be shaped to further the outcomes of entrepreneurial activities and entrepreneurs. From the perspective of the person, focus is given to the individual entrepreneur and the mindset that characterizes entrepreneurs. In this respect, research reports, for example, that entrepreneurs possess cognitive characteristics and engage in decision-making processes that distinguish them from a typical manager. For example, entrepreneurs are reported to display more initiative, to be more tolerant of ambiguity, and to take more risks than their manager cohorts. Some interesting research also reports that entrepreneurs more often use an effectual logic rather than a rational foresight and predictive logic to make business decisions. Without getting too much into the weeds here, let me explain. Using rational logic, typical managers predict the future and then set performance goals based on their predictions. Opportunities are evaluated for their upside potential and pursued based upon a calculation of their expected value. Competition is analyzed with the attitude of protecting what you have and maximizing your share of that opportunity. Unexpected events are conceived as bad, and careful prediction, planning, and focus are viewed as a way to minimize their impact. Now compare that to effectual logic, which research suggests that entrepreneurs typically apply. Entrepreneurs view the future as in part co-created through their own efforts and set goals based upon imagining different courses of actions. Opportunities are then evaluated for their downside loss and pursued based upon a calculation of affordable losses. Competition is analyzed with the attitude of building partnerships to shape the future, and unexpected events are embraced and conceived of as good, with imaginative rethinking viewed as a way to transform unexpected events into new opportunities. Thus, what we find is the entrepreneur differs from our typical manager in terms of their cognitive properties, but also varies from an important benchmark in antitrust, which is rationality, or at least boundedly rational thinking, what we call the economic man. As we'll see today, this type of difference plays a role in how we can think about the interplay of entrepreneurship and antitrust. Focus is given to the conduct of entrepreneurship. Here we're talking about the activities that describe entrepreneurial practice. In this context, research reports distinctive stages and phases associated with entrepreneurial activity. For example, one portrayal of the entrepreneurial process identifies these stages to conclude entrepreneurial alertness, recognition of an opportunity, innovation, and exploitation of the opportunity. Another description of the process identifies the stages as identification of an opportunity, assessment of the opportunity, acquisition of necessary resources, and implementation. And finally, another depiction includes the phases of idea generation, opportunity evaluation, planning, company formation, launch, and growth. Now, an interesting commonality across these definitions, each of these as I've laid them out, is that each emphasizes the kind of upfront activities or these early stage conduct of the entrepreneurial process. For example, that I mentioned entrepreneurial alertness, identification or recognition of an opportunity, idea generation, innovation, opportunity evaluation, planning. All of these actually come before a new venture is formed, before one enters the market. And I think, as we'll see today, this type of emphasis on the upfront, early stage, pre-market entry types of stages or activities is also important for us understanding antitrust. Finally, from the perspective of the place, focus is given to the organizational form in which the entrepreneur resides and these activities I've spoken about occurs. So for example, research recognizes that although commonly viewed as an individual or small independent business phenomenon, the reality is that entrepreneurship is not form specific. It can be associated with almost any form of organization. For example, larger organizations, think here, Apple and Google, and the list goes on, can be and are entrepreneurial. Moreover, divisions, units, departments, and other sub-organizations of a firm can be entrepreneurial. I'm told this is called intrapreneurial. Other forms of entrepreneurial organization include the type of venture involved, and we'll hear more about that today in our second panel, and the larger network and ecosystem in which entrepreneurial activity occurs and entrepreneurs reside. And we'll hear more about that as well today. The important takeaway here is that entrepreneurship is not limited to the individual entrepreneur or to the small independent firm, but can manifest in any form of organization. And really, to totally, truly understand entrepreneurship, one needs to go beyond the organization and understand that larger ecosystem. As we'll see today, both of these points are important for understanding that interplay that is a focus of our efforts. In terms of our sessions, our first panel today, which includes two successful entrepreneurs and an expert on small business, is really going to be helpful for helping us to further understand the entrepreneur, the entrepreneurial process, as well as the entrepreneurial organization. So each of the different perspectives of entrepreneurship, these three P's that I've been talking about, really results in different questions for those interested in the interplay of entrepreneurship and antitrust. And these questions then begin to shift towards our second panel and session today. For example, from the perspective of the entrepreneurial person, important questions concern, for example, the extent and under what circumstances does competition theory and antitrust practice recognize and incorporate understanding of the distinctive mindset and these cognitive properties that I spoke of earlier. More particularly, for example, how well does competition theory recognize that entrepreneurs possess cognitive characteristics and engage in decision making that differs from the typical manager and that differs from that standard of rationality or even boundedly rationality? Similarly, what extent does antitrust practice give weight to these characteristics? From the perspective of the entrepreneurial process, important questions concern the extent and under what circumstances are both theory and practice in antitrust recognize and incorporate those different stages of the entrepreneurial practice. Here, what we're focusing on is how well does competition theory recognize those upfront activities that are emphasized in the entrepreneurial process? For example, in predicting the effects of competitive conduct, to what degree does competition theory acknowledge the activities that occur at the early stages of a venture formation, pre-market entry? Similarly, to what extent does antitrust practice incorporate these things? From the perspective of the entrepreneurial place, important questions concern the extent and under what conditions theory and antitrust practice recognize and incorporate the various organizational forms of entrepreneurship that I mentioned. Here, we think in terms of how well does competition theory recognize the different organizational forms in which entrepreneurs reside and entrepreneurial activity takes place. For example, in predicting the effects of competitive conduct, to what degree does competition theory acknowledge that the scope of organization for entrepreneurship spans from individuals to larger firms and includes that larger ecosystem? And similarly for antitrust practice. As I noted, our second panel today will focus on these particular questions. And that panel will include academic experts from entrepreneurship, economics, and antitrust. Finally then, our focus today on the interplay of entrepreneurship and antitrust has the potential to be very significant. It really does, because there's just not much of this type of thought occurring. Let me tease out some of those connections for you. First of all, entrepreneurship is widely recognized as a prime contributor to economic progress. As found in economics, considerable research suggests that the state of our economic welfare, our standard of living in industrialized companies owes much more to dynamic efficiencies in the form of innovation than to static efficiencies achieved through economies of scale, scope, and coordination. And of course, economic progress and innovation is important to antitrust, both in terms of our efficiency criterion and more particularly in the form of what we refer to as dynamic efficiency, which refers to productive innovation. Third, some evidence, and there's debate around this, suggests that the state of entrepreneurship in the United States and globally is on the decline and has been for some time. For example, the Kauffman Foundation reports that entrepreneurial activity, as measured by the occurrence of new business ownership, has declined since 2010 and is now at levels found prior to the Great Recession. In addition, other measures, including the share of new firms to all firms, indicate a downward trend in entrepreneurs and entrepreneurial activity over the past 30 years. The answer, however, to whether our focus today on the interplay of entrepreneurship and antitrust is in fact significant requires some additional inquiry. And this is going to be the focus of our third panel, our third session. The type of inquiry at that panel will be, for example, understanding whether antitrust as currently conceived and practiced, does it positively affect the relationship of entrepreneurship and economic growth through innovation? Here, for example, the question reduces to, does the existing approach, for example, to mergers and non-merger conduct result in outcomes that encourage the three P's, entrepreneurs, the entrepreneurial process, and the entrepreneurial organization? A second question, depending on the answer to the first question, is whether or not as antitrust as potentially conceived and practiced in the future could positively affect the relationship of entrepreneurship and economic growth going forward. As we'll see today, answers to these two questions are really necessary before we can reach a conclusion that our focus today is of significance. And as I mentioned, our third panel will be focusing on this particular question. Well, with that, let me introduce our first panel, which I mentioned includes two accomplished entrepreneurs, as well as an expert on independent business. Our first speaker is Mike Callicrate. Mike is a farmer rancher, business entrepreneur, and family fam advocate. Considered the go-to expert on the negative consequences of industrial meat production, he has served as an advisor for the films Food Inc. and Fresh, and for several best-selling books, including Fast Food Nation and The Omnivore's Dilemma. As an entrepreneur, Mike formed Ranch Food Direct, a branded beef company. The fabrication plant and retail store based in Colorado Springs processes and markets high-quality meats, along with many other local artisan food products. Mike also developed the Callicrate Bander, a patent invention now recognized worldwide as the preferred method for humane, drug-free livestock castration. Along the way, Mike has been actively involved in many social and political efforts. It's a needed part of the cattle processing business, okay? As Mike's gonna tell you. Along the way, Mike has actually also been involved in many social and political efforts to improve the welfare of family farms and restore effectively publicly regulated markets. So please join me in welcoming Mike Callicrate.
Thanks, Greg. Castration. What a great way to start out. And you know, with the thought that popped in my head when you said that was, did any of you ever know the former CEO and president of IBP, Bob Peterson? Why did that name pop in my head? It just did. And I probably shouldn't have admitted that. So thank you for having me here, Greg. I really appreciate this opportunity. And you know, when we think about antitrust, I think it's something we ought to have. And competitive markets, I think that would be a really cool idea. to maybe have competitive markets one day. So we're working on it, right? Yeah. So in 1975, I graduated from Colorado State University with an animal science degree. And I tell people, don't confuse that with animal husbandry. This is industrial. I mean, I got out of there with everything industrial in my head, throughput, economies of scale, all of that about return on invested capital. Don't be afraid to borrow money. You know, we're going to feed the world, right? There's no way this is you're going to have a great life. Just go. And so I got out of Colorado State University to go back to the farm and ranch, and there really wasn't enough room there. There it couldn't really make enough of a living there to raise a family. So I built a 14,000 head feedlot when I was 27 years old with 9 other local people that were involved in that feedlot. And it was about 8 years later that I left that feed yard and I really built a nice one, this one. So my second one was really, really nice, but still 12,000 head. And don't, you know, that's a small feedlot. JBS has got one in Yuma, Colorado, 70 miles away, that's 130,000 cattle. So really a pretty small kind of an operation, but still very much industrial. There wasn't a performance enhancing drug that I just didn't adopt even before it was on the market. I mean, I was all over this stuff. And so anyway, this is the feedlot in St. Francis, Kansas, the second one that I built that I own by myself. And so I was going along, it was about 1988, and I started getting the feeling that, you know what, there's not a lot of competition in this market. When I started out in 1978, I had a choice of 20 buyers that I could sell finished cattle to. I can just hear it in my head. I mean, this was awesome. I would come to work on a Monday morning and there would be a car parked outside of the gate and the guy sleeping. And it wasn't some guy, it wasn't a homeless person. It was a meatpacker buyer. And they wanted the first chance at our show list that week. And these are all companies that were thriving. These are all companies that had markets themselves to a very decentralized retail and wholesale and distribution system. And it was really great. And I was really thinking it was okay. But then as time progressed and IBP, thinking about Bob Peterson, and Cargill and Montfort, soon to become ConAgra, then Swift, and now JBS. These companies were putting their competition out of business, and I was thinking, I've got fewer buyers, this is getting ridiculous, and I started speaking out. And so by 1988, Bob Peterson had spoke to a group of cattlemen there in Kansas and said, look, the other guys, which was ConAgra and Cargill, are both owning their own cattle, and if you guys don't do something about it, you know, IBP's got to do something. And boy, did they ever. They developed the formula to buy cattle and to hold those animals in captive supply to where it even reduced the competition even more. So by 1996, I'd filed the lawsuit along with 9 other cattle producers against IBP for anti-competitive practices. That worked its way through the courts. And by 1999, these big meat packers had just totally quit buying from me. And here I am in this place right here with 14,000 head of cattle and a 12,000 head feedlot and couldn't sell them. And they weren't all mine. I mean, I called up Dan Glickman, Secretary of Agriculture. I says, Dan, I knew him. He was my representative. I says, Dan, what am I going to do? I said, why don't you enforce the Packers and Stockyards Act? He says, well, you know, Mike, today we've got a global market and we need big meat companies that can do business globally. And I said, really? Well, what about me? So he called ConAgra up and made him buy all my cattle. And then here we are in 1999 with a completely empty facility. So, you know, I wasn't alone. There's been 39,000 of these operations go out of business in the last 20 to 30 years because of this meatpacker concentration, lack of antitrust law enforcement. And the impact on our community. St. Francis schools have lost 2/3 of their students. This is what the grocery store looked like in St. Francis, Kansas for a couple of years. It's now been repurchased by another group, and it's got some things on the shelf, but it's just like it's the same food you get at any bodega on this. I mean, it's really, really bad food. Even farmers don't have access to good food. And speaking of farmers, I mean, really, who are these guys and who cares, right? Well, Ben Franklin said, this is really cool, our founding father said, you know, there's basically three ways to accumulate wealth. You can conquer it the way the Romans do. You can steal it the way corporations do. He was talking about the East India Company. Or you can create it. A farmer puts a seed in the ground that has water and sunshine, and it is as if in a continual miracle, wealth is created. So these are really, really important people that we need to make sure that they do okay, that we support them, and not let the predators of big agribusiness put them out of business. So this is what happens to your town, and this is my friend John Tyson. I met him in 2002. We had this little conversation at the National Cattlemen's Beef Association meeting in San Antonio, and this is what he said. He says, why are you suing us? You should be suing Walmart. We have no choice because they tell us what they're going to pay. We have to pay you less. The problem is he's in a position to do so. That is the problem. He's in a position to do so because he has the market power to push down on suppliers instead of going up to Walmart and saying, look, we got to have more. So total loss of competition. And if you read The Meat Racket, you're going to know where this guy ended up. Joining the billionaire club with his feet on the neck of chicken growers. Lack of antitrust law enforcement. Land-grant universities have done nothing to help the entrepreneur. They've done nothing to help the farmer. In fact, they've taken on the role of supporting big agribusiness and global corporations. So what do you do? What do you do? Well, let's figure this out. Let's not do this industrial stuff anymore. Let's do a complete 180 and go sustainable, humane. You know, let's get rid of all this performance-enhancing drug sickness in our heads. Really, let's look for other alternatives. What about some disruptive technology, like slaughtering animals where they're at instead of hauling them 200 miles or 600 miles if you live in South Dakota? What about a mobile slaughter unit that can come right to the farm and set it up inside this building right here, and be able to process animals right where they're at? Saving the freight on 33%, 37% actually, of the freight that you would have paid on a live animal. Keeping the slaughter waste behind to fertilize your soils and compost. What about the bones? What if we turn those into biochar and fertilize? It's 37% phosphorus, 35% calcium, unbelievable nutrients for our soils. You know, what about growing more food for local consumption? And so this is what we did. In 2000, after being closed and for about a year, as we started a company called Ranch Foods Direct. And Harry Green, a student, actually an Olympian, and just entering grad school now, Harry came out, and he's really into all the sustainable regenerative ag stuff. And he took this picture of what we got going on. So here we're collecting rainwater. We got our biochar unit over here. You know, we rotationally graze. What do you do with a 12,000 head feedlot when you don't need 12,000 head anymore? And you're never going to go back to selling to the big packers. Well, let's start a heifer development program. That's a really a good place to be here, since we've just sold the smallest calf crop since 1941, and we really do need to rebuild our herd in the U.S. Let's do some raised beds here and grow food that we can eat and we can market through Ranch Foods Direct. Ranch Foods Direct is a facility in Colorado Springs. Basically, what we do is we bring our carcasses in either this small truck or in a big semi truck that'll hold about 60 animals, and then in this building here is a big carcass cooler where we hang those carcasses, and then the meat gets cut up here, sold in the retail store. This little retail store is 800 square feet. It does about $45,000 in sales every week. And we've also got about 120 restaurants. Colorado College is one of our bigger accounts, Bon Appetit. So we're really getting into that institutional and restaurant market more. Just bought a company called Federal Foods. We're gonna be getting more into the wholesale distribution and adding a lot more just besides meat to what we market. This is the industrial food pantry. Basically, what this is the competition. This is the lack of competition that's in the market. And everywhere I go, people are really, really hesitant to talk about these guys. They don't want to say that Whole Foods isn't really nice. They don't want to say that Chipotle isn't nice, that Chipotle's got this great marketing slogan that says, you know, food with integrity. Well, doggone it, I don't know of anybody whose marketing program is so far away from operations. It's like they do business on different planets. But, you know, Chipotle drops domestic local production and goes to Australia because it's a whole lot cheaper to buy meat from Australia. And so this is my new IBP right here. So as I enter into the food business, I get rid of IBP and worrying about where I'm going to sell my fat cattle, now to worrying about the predatory pricing, the kickbacks, and all of the abusive market practices of this company right here in the restaurant business. And for those who want, you can go to my blog and read the letter I wrote to the FTC about the Sysco US Foods merger. So, you know, basically I get up every day trying to figure out how to increase income at the farm and ranch gate. How do we get more farmers and ranchers on the land? How do we build a food system that serves the interests of those who invest the capital, take the risk, and do the work, and provide really great food to people? So, thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Mike, for that overview of your business model and discussions of some of the competitive challenges as well as the reactions that you have been involved in as it relates to entrepreneurship. I'd like to introduce our next speaker, who is Craig Purser. He's president and CEO of the National Beer Wholesalers Association. Mike serves as a leading advocate for over 3,000 licensed independent beer distributors across the country. In this role, he is responsible for the strategic development and tactical execution of the association's mission in the areas of government, public, industry, and political efforts. Craig is well known for his entrepreneurial efforts to strengthen the three-tier system of beer distribution and state-based alcohol regulation. Under his leadership, he's worked with a wide variety of stakeholders to help, for example, Congress pass the Sober Truth on Preventing Underage Drinking, known as STOP Act. This legislation emphasizes the primary responsibility of the states to regulate alcohol, addresses health and safety issues related to underage drinking, and authorizes grants that support innovative prevention efforts. He's a veteran of Capitol Hill and numerous political campaigns, and Greg also has been a guest lecturer at the University of North Carolina, the George Washington University here in D.C., and at the University of Oklahoma. Please join me then in welcoming Craig Purser.
Thank you, and good morning. I'll tell you, I love the combination already of beef and beer. I mean, you know, these guys have got a saying, you know, beef, it's what's for dinner. I was recently at a meeting of the Florida Beer Wholesalers, and I just did a little turn of phrase on their keyword, and I said, beer, it's not just for breakfast anymore. So anyway, thank you guys for having me this morning. I appreciate the opportunity to be here to talk, you know, and it's kind of like Admiral Stockdale in that 1992 vice presidential debate, who am I and why am I here? That kind of a dynamic here. But, you know, there's a lot of, I'm a big believer in analogies, and as it relates to our interest together in preserving some of the things that are important to America, things like quality jobs at quality wages with good benefits. And when we talk about this economy and how important it is, and we talk about our theme for today, which is entrepreneurship, I think it's a great way to bring people together and talk about different ways. You know, I would say to skin the cat, but that sounds kind of anti-animal, but we've already been talking about castration, so I think it's okay. But anyway, kind of to tell you a little bit about me and who I represent the interest of over 3,300 independent companies. These are companies that are primarily family-owned and operated. All are privately held. And they are much more in tune with the economic and commercial values of Main Street in their communities rather than Wall Street. And that's not to run down business. That's not to be anti-competitive. That's not any of those things. It's just important, not unlike the independent farmers and ranchers out there, my members aren't working for a quarterly dividend. They aren't working to meet a number, and it's just important to know that. My members employ over 130,000 hardworking men and women directly. So even though we're a very small segment of the economy, we put a lot of food on folks' tables, and that's an important thing to remember in this day and age, particularly when we talk about the nexus between entrepreneurship and antitrust. You know, to kind of get started, we need to recognize that alcohol is a unique product. It's a product that's not designed to be, in spite of what I said about breakfast anymore, it's not designed to be consumed anytime, anyplace, anywhere. We have intense feelings about alcohol. Alcohol is the only consumer product that is the subject of two constitutional amendments. But it's important to note that sometimes there's a difference between the consumer's interest and the public's interest. Annually, Gallup asked the question, and the results are that nearly a third of the American public does not consume alcohol for moral, for religious, for health, for personal choice reasons. And that's important to remember, because a lot of times, as advocates in an industry and as marketers and all these things that we do, we forget that. The Center for Disease Control estimates that 88,000 lives are lost annually due to alcohol use and its misuse. And again, very important to recognize and realize the fact that this is not a product that's like a lot of others. And alcohol, finally, is subject to significant regulation with a goal of maintaining an orderly market and effective revenue collection. Whether you like all of your states or your community's alcohol regulations, they're all rooted in one of two principles, either control or revenue collection. That's important to remember. You're going to hear this kind of as a resounding theme from me this morning. An open and independent distribution and retail system equals entrepreneurship in beer. We have a very successful story in this industry, and we don't want to go the way of the independent farmers and ranches. As a matter of fact, we've got a marvelous dynamic to celebrate from an industry standpoint. In 1983, there were fewer than 50 breweries in the U.S. Let me say that again. In 1983, there were fewer than 50 breweries, and today there are over 3,400. That is an American success story, and that has been done because of an independent distribution system. Because we have a regulatory structure that supports and facilitates this independence, we have given rise to in this incredible success of new entrepreneurs, access to market, et cetera. More choice and variety, this according to the Nielsen organization, more choice and variety in alcohol than any other consumer good. Now, there's a footnote in this paper that I'm citing that says that women's cosmetics may actually be close. But it's important to note, tremendous choice and variety. And, you know, when you think about it, and I want everybody to close their eyes and think about where you buy beer. Whether you're a beer drinker or not, you may be a wine drinker, you may be one of those third consumers that don't partake in alcohol consumptions. But there have been just an entire cold box, if you would, at your favorite retailer that's been created in the last 10 to 20 years. There's beer being put on the floor. There's tremendous, tremendous access to market and ability to get to market. And we're proud of that. We like to celebrate that. That's the beer aisle. Interestingly, when we look at other beverages, it's not always the same story. Interestingly, when you think about just four or five shelves over, there is a very different dynamic. Let me go back to that and go back to that. And part of that is because of the regulatory system under which we operate. All this patchwork of states, all these unique laws that everybody loves to rail against and say, why can't I get Chateau Screwtop? Or why can't I get, you know, the newest craft brew from six states away? Well, typically, that's because that brewer doesn't want to be in that marketplace because it's part of their plan to create a lure, to create interest. And if it's wine, it may be because it's sold on allocation and you're not on the list. Now, interestingly, when you go to this account, I didn't have the chance to check here at the National Press Club, but I'll bet you dollars to donuts that you can either get a Coke or a Pepsi at the bar upstairs or downstairs. And that's the soft drink business. There is not a federal prohibition specifically on slotting fees or there's not a series of state laws that restrict that market access. Again, very interesting and awesome contrast when we look to beer. So why, again, who am I and why am I here? And this just illustrates a little bit different. I realize this is this is an antitrust presentation, and I do have references to price here, so I'm duly noted, and I'm going to spill a glass of water and call myself out here. But the demonstration of this slide is to show that it is indeed the newest manufacturers, the importers and the craft brewers that are having the most success as far as growth and as far as price stability. Again, that's important, but what I want to talk to you about today is making sure that this is maintained, that we see that we continue to have, because of this system, a robust and strong story to tell. Now, this just looks a little bit at the brewer's growth. I made mention of what we've seen over the last 30 years, but you can see that the real growth is in the smallest of manufacturers. And that's terrific. That demonstrates that while there is a robust regulatory system in place, the barriers to entry and the ability to get established is very, very small. Now, we all know theories of economics. We know about the whole notion of scalability. We know about the difficulty in sustaining that growth. But again, we're here to point out and talk about the success that exists. But the interesting thing is there are potentially some storm clouds on the horizon. There are market forces and industry participants and folks that would like to, like to change this in some way, shape, or form. And I want to talk about that. Again, this illustrates there when people, and it drives me crazy, and when people talk about a free market in alcohol, there's not a free market in alcohol. There never has been. There is an orderly market with intense interbrand competition. And it pains some of my libertarian friends to just say, why is this? Why can't we break this down and have harmonization or normalization or a one-size-fits-all solution to alcohol policy? Well, we did have that. We had it 81 years ago when it was called Prohibition. And we had a uniform application. Every state in the union could, the sale and transportation and manufacture of alcohol was prohibited for 13 years. And it's just important to note that this system works very well. People in my home state of Oklahoma feel very differently about alcohol than people in New York City. And I tell people this all the time. Oklahoma doesn't want New York's liquor laws, and I assure you, New York City does not want Oklahoma's. So anyway, this is just kind of sets this up. But it's interesting because there are a number of folks that are recognizing this and a number of folks that are realizing this, and that's the positive component to our kind of case study here. And I know some of the folks in the room are familiar with Barry Lynn, but in his book, Cornered, the New Monopoly Capitalism, he says, "So it is with beer. The only real protection that all the hundreds of small brewers in this country enjoy, the only real force that keeps Anheuser-Busch InBev and South African breweries from rolling up these tiny pockets of profit and distraction is the 21st Amendment to the Constitution." So again, he's bringing this back to this. It's the 21st Amendment to the Constitution doesn't say anything about market access, but Section 2 speaks loudly and clearly to the primacy of the state's ability to regulate. So I wanted to share that with you. Again, my refrain, that open and independent distribution and retail equals entrepreneurship and beer. When we talk about open and independent, there are kind of two veins of law that worked to support this at the state level. At retail, tied house laws allow retailers to run their businesses, not brewers or distributors. Retailers make independent decisions that are in the consumer's interest. And this is important. The whole notion of the tied house sounds like an antiquated tune. It reminds us and harkens back to the days of the saloon, where the saloon was literally owned by an out-of-state or out-of-mind interest. The whole notion of a tied house and the expression lock, stock, and barrel, a lot of people recognize that and think that that's all exclusive to the to a firearm and a history of our nation in the veins maybe of the Second Amendment, but it is indeed the whole notion of being in hawk or being owned by an interest right down to the lock on the door, to the stock in the back and the barrel that the product arrived in. And if, and so it's important to note that these laws that are primarily state laws, but the Federal Alcohol Administration Act also recognizes these, are important for maintaining that orderly marketplace and really maintaining a level playing field between market participants. Now at distribution, state laws allow distributors to bring any supplier to market without supplier interference. And this is really important because the ability to take on, the reason we've seen all this growth in a large part is due to the contract and the state laws that exist. And the contract, just, you know, like Mike would say, as it relates to the beef producers, the contract is very onerous. The contract demands all kinds of things from the distributor. But the state law works to level that and oftentimes will allow that distributor complete free choice to ensure that they are operating their business independently. And so that's why 20 years ago, 25 years ago, as brands like Sam Adams were getting established, when Boston Beer was going to market, they were able to freely be taken on by distributors of other competing brands. And they were able to do that without fear of retribution from those larger brewers. Same thing is true now as Sam Adams has grown and some of those newer, more local products want to get established. Those laws exist to prohibit Sam Adams from unfairly controlling or punishing the distributor for taking on that smaller competing brand. Another piece of work came out last year by the Boston Consulting Group, and what they did was they looked at the model and they looked at the ease of entry and, in effect, what had happened for these small manufacturers to be able to get to market because of an independent and open distribution system. And that report, a couple of highlights, the U.S. beer market is open, freely competitive, and driven by consumer choice. The ability of small brewers to gain access to the marketplace through independent distributors is a major reason that brewers are able to exist at all. Interesting piece of copy. You got Barry Lynn maybe on one side of the world saying what he's saying, and you've got Boston Consulting saying this. Interestingly, the marketplace really is regulatory Jenga. Jenga, I was at a, it might surprise you that I spent a lot of time in bars in my job, but I was at a bar in North Carolina recently, and if, I don't know if you guys have ever seen this, it's a giant Jenga game that's about this big, and it's played with planks of wood. It's actually very conducive for beer drinking. But the whole notion that I'm trying to illustrate here is that this regulatory structure is not unlike the fabric of a sweater. And lots of times, if you've got a sweater on and you pull on that piece of that thread, very quickly the sweater becomes unraveled. And that's why when we talk to groups and we talk to folks, some of these policies need to be very thoughtfully considered because of the unintended consequences. Again, my refrain, but this is just a couple of quotes of folks that of what folks have said about the system. Where else can you have a 4% market share and make money? That's Dolph Vandenbrink, who's the CEO of Heineken USA. Obviously, Heineken USA is a global conglomerate. They operate in a whole host of marketplaces. And where they do business, it is unusual for a 4-share market player to be successful. That's just a fact. Heineken operates in many parts of the world where they are an 80 or 90% market player, and that's worth noting. Jim Cook, the founder of Boston Beer, says, I'm 1% of the market, and I'm making money. And then a gentleman by the name of, I think it's Eric Lars Nelson, who's the head of the North Carolina Brewers Guild, put it probably best a year or two ago, where he said, no three-tier, talking about the three-tier distribution system, no craft beer. And that's just important to note as we talk about this. The Brewers Association is the organization that represents America's craft brewers. They're headquartered in Boulder, Colorado. And they support the notion of an independent distributor. And the whole notion of independent, and you know, we don't agree with all of these organizations on everything. As a matter of fact, you're supposed to disagree. That's okay. But when it comes to an independent system, this is very important. Now, what I was asked to kind of present to you guys today is a little bit of a thumbnail sketch of something that's happened very recently in antitrust world and how it could and might have affected us. And that's, of course, in 2012, Anheuser-Busch exercised its, well, it wasn't an option. They actually made an acquisition of the controlling interest of the other 50% of Grupo Modelo. Grupo Modelo is the was the owner of the Corona and Modelo beer brands in Mexico. Interestingly, Anheuser-Busch, the old Anheuser-Busch before its acquisition by InBev in 2008, has held a 50% non-controlling interest in Grupo Modelo since 1993 or so. But they went ahead and moved forward in 2012 with and this copy is kind of hard to read, but they agreed to purchase that 50% equity position for $20.1 billion. Pretty big for half of something when you think about it. But an interesting play, in as much as their original first shot out of the blocks was, in preparing for the regulator's review, their proposal was to actually give the importation rights so that there would be, you know, a firewall for antitrust purposes to Constellation, which is a wine and spirits and beer importer and producer, for a 10-year hold. It would be a 10-year contract. And then at the end of that 10 years, it would be up for review. And interestingly, in our world, Corona and the group of Modelo brands is roughly a 5 or 6 share brand. It's growing. There's tremendous interest. It's the fastest growing import. It's a wonderful, wonderful product. But the problem that would have presented would have been significant for my members, because in many states, you are able to terminate a distributor not for cause or specific non-performance, but just because of a change in ownership. And so the concern to my interest and my folks was, what will happen in year 7 of this 10-year deal? What will happen to the stability of our marketplace? These are distributors that have grown and built the Corona brand in the U.S. since it came in the 1980s. Just to tremendous value, obviously, globally, for 50% of it, somebody's willing to pay $20 billion, but its equity has been built by my members. And so we were very involved, along with others in the industry, in working with the Department of Justice to educate them on the American beer industry. And also part of that education is the fact that Anheuser-Busch is the largest beer distributor in the country. Now, I talked about the three-tiered system. I talked about the whole notion of a producer. Maybe I actually didn't, about the whole notion of a supplier, a distributor, and a retailer. But this created additional problems for us. And so, but from a timeline standpoint, you had this proposal. You had, after six and a half months of review, you actually had the department step in and sue to stop the proposed deal. And we were pleased to see that because of the concerns that I laid out. But, you know, and it's very interesting. It's not a surprise from a political standpoint. More of my members are what I call small town or small R Republicans. They're business owners, but they're relationship folks, so they work with everybody, but I often remind them that they can thank the activist Obama administration for stepping in and stopping this merger, because it would have been bad for everyone. And interestingly, quickly after that, there was an agreement, and obviously the final order reflected this, that for the purposes of the ownership of Corona in perpetuity in the United States, Constellation would buy it. Justice also required, or it was stipulated, that they purchase the newest brewery that was closest to the United States, making Constellation not just an importer, but a brewer. And again, the net result was very positive for my members, because it provided that bit of stability. Obviously, with the Tunney Act and with some of the other provisions, there is additional scrutiny for a 3-year period on next steps by Anheuser-Busch InBev, and I'm going to talk a little bit about those. I just went the wrong way. And interestingly, in the order, DOJ said some things that are important, because, again, Anheuser-Busch is the nation's largest Anheuser-Busch distributor. They currently own and self-distribute about 10% of their volume. And I'll talk about that in just a moment. But DOJ said effective distribution is important for a brewer to be competitive in the beer industry. That was part of the competitive impact statement. Like I mentioned, they're the nation's largest AB distributor. In 2009, it was highly reported in the investor community that ABI's was interest in growing its ownership of distribution up to 50%. And you can imagine, as it relates to our members, that's a cause for concern. How are they going to do that without displacing these member companies that are their distributors? Very, very interesting. They currently own distribution in 11 states. They've expanded their ownership in 5 of those states. But conversely, a number of states have taken action since 2009 to prohibit their ownership, to limit their interest in vertical integration. And that's been very positive, I think, because it helps solidify this successful model that's worked so well for so many. The other thing is, obviously, those Anheuser-Busch distributors, with the exception of very little exception in Oregon and Washington State, exclusively sell Anheuser-Busch products. So if you're a new manufacturer that's looking to get to market and you've got a variety of choices or different ways to go, a significant one is off of the table if you can't go to your local Anheuser-Busch distributor. So likewise, that's a concern. And then one other issue that's important and that's got us very concerned is their acquisition of brew pubs or small brewers with retail privileges. This is very important because a lot of these retail privileges were created by states to help these new manufacturers get established, to create a demand for the products. And it will be very interesting to see if in their ambition, they seek to widen this gap and take advantage of those marketplace size differentials that were created to help folks get established. Interesting stuff. Also, in the Department of Justice, I made mention that there's 3 years of intense review of acquisition and a change to the standard of deals that need to be approved, and we're appreciative of that when it comes to DOJ's action. And so, you know, if I were to leave you with something, it's that we want DOJ to continue that oversight. We think that that's real important, and we think that there are things that can be done to help maintain this orderly marketplace that works so well for others. In the interest of time, I won't get all the way into these other provisions, but there is an analogy to the beef world or to the chicken world as it relates to market power by producers. One of the things that Anheuser-Busch InBev has done is they've sought to, in effect, put forward their own tournament theory of competition that actually could pit distributor against distributor. They are asking people to be on their team as it relates to what brands they distribute. And this, you guys, is very potentially anti-competitive. It's very, very, very troubling when a manufacturer or a master, in a sense, blesses one set of brands and condemns another. It could be very, very troubling. It's anti-competitive, and you know, just want to put it on your radar screen, because and this isn't stuff we made up. This is ripped directly from their consolidation guide, as it relates to being able to help drive and guide what products a distributor would be able to carry. They also ask very boldly, do you share the same vision as we do on issues of importance to the industry, including to support legislation that can affect our competitive position? Very interesting. You know, a hammer knows a nail, and people put forward things in an effort to get a certain kind of behavior in marketplaces. But this is very troubling, and it's certainly something that I think that we can work on together, because we see nothing but downside as it relates not just to our economic interest, but that of the other folks that we represent. And interestingly, it's not just Anheuser-Busch InBev when it comes to exercising market power. In 2008, we had, of course, the acquisition of Anheuser-Busch by InBev, but we also had Miller and Coors form a joint venture in the United States. And, of course, that's South African breweries Miller, and that is Molson Coors. Again, global players, no disparity for those folks, but they don't sell alcohol anywhere else in the world like they do in the United States. And that's true. That's part of why this is such a successful and such a competitive marketplace. But because of this, they attempted to terminate 40 independents because of the acquisition, because of the merger. And their supplier contracts, I made mention of this early, give them great latitude as far as controlling that distributor's business. And again, that's troubling. It's concern. We are very glad that we have state laws and state regulation that sometimes can help guide the interpretation of those contracts. And then also it's important to note big retailers are working at changing the laws too. If I were given this presentation a half dozen years ago, I would talk about the fact that of the Fortune 50 companies in the United States, 17 or 18 of them are beer retailers. When you think about that, that's kind of staggering. But whether it's a convenience channel, a grocery channel, a fuel and petrol channel, those are, and that's not what they do exclusively, but that demonstrates the market power of the others in this industry and the influence that they hold. And again, this is just kind of recapping. Many but not all state beer franchise laws have provisions that ban a supplier from controlling a distributor's companion brands. If we see action that is anti-competitive, I think you can see more interest in strengthening these types of laws. And then, of course, it begs the question, is it fair for brewers, regardless of size, to tell distributors what they can or can't carry? I think very clearly the answer is no, it's not fair. One of the things that I'd be remiss if I didn't recognize is the great work of this organization. You guys have weighed in on these issues, particularly in with regard to the more recent reviews, the DOJ review of the Modelo deal, which we appreciate. One of the things that you said in one of your communications says that Anheuser-Busch could expand its exclusive dealing with distributors to give its large brand portfolio a competitive advantage over small rivals. This is the kind of work together that I mentioned. This is the kind of thing that we're appreciative of. We want to continue to be a resource. Diana, we appreciate your leadership and involving us here. This is terrific, and I'm looking forward to some of our questions. Kind of in closing, what more can be done to protect this entrepreneurial opportunity? And number one, it's strong merger enforcement and opposing anti-competitive acquisitions or additional vertical integration by large brewers. And when I say this, I'm going to go back and I'm going to check my phone to see if there's been any more rumor, because we are in a 24/7 global world, and there, if you Google Anheuser-Busch, InBev, Diageo today, that was the flavor of the week last week, that Anheuser-Busch or 3G, which is its ownership equity firm, may move on Diageo, which is the world's largest beer, wine, and spirits maker. There's all kinds of stories out there. There's a lot been written and speculated about a tie-up between Anheuser-Busch InBev and South African breweries. Obviously, this is the United States, and fortunately, we have antitrust laws that are designed to help level this playing field, but nonetheless, very concerning. Number two, we want to investigate ongoing supplier efforts to restrict competing or companion brands. Very, very important. Citations from their own communications are very troubling to us, and we think that in this area, sunshine is a great antiseptic. And then obviously support state laws that promote distributor independence. Like I mentioned, there have been, I think, 9 states that have worked to limit Anheuser-Busch's expansion by owning branches, but very, very important that we help put forward public policies that can support the notion of an independent tier. I think for my next presentation, Mike, I'm gonna put up some beef slides here, because, but in the meantime, this will have to do. We don't want this. We want this. And in conclusion, like I said at the outset, open and independent distribution and retail equals entrepreneurship and beer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Craig, and terrific. We've had two case studies now that help us to understand the linkage between the competitive environment and entrepreneurship and its benefits to society. Our third speaker is Stacy Mitchell. She's co-director for the Institute for Local Self-Reliance. She directs the Institute's initiatives on community banking and independent business. As part of her efforts, she was among the first to raise questions about the rise of mega retailers in the 1990s and their efforts, effects rather, for the economy and for small business. In fact, Stacy's best-selling book, Big Box Swindle, The True Cost of Mega Retailers and the Fight for America's Independent Businesses, has been described as one of the ultimate accounts of the single most important economic trend in our country. Stacy's analysis and advice is widely sought by policymakers, community activists, and small business groups. She's been a keynote speaker at many conferences, and you may have, as 25,000 others have, viewed her TED Talk online entitled Why We Can't Shop Our Way to a Better Economy. Please join me in welcoming Stacy Mitchell.
Wow. Beef, beer, I'm going to add prescription drugs and toys to the mix, so it's going to really be quite a morning. Well, it's really terrific to be here. I helped to coordinate an alliance of small business trade associations that formed about a year and a half ago called the Advocates for Independent Business. It's made up of 15 small business trade groups. They represent about 150,000 small businesses across the country. And market power and antitrust was really one of the animating issues that drove the formation of this alliance. So when I told them that you all were hosting this symposium today, they were just really thrilled and really just so glad to see that this is part of your agenda. So, I want to start by kind of putting my cards on the table. I think we made a huge mistake 30 or 40 years ago when we decided that antitrust policy was no longer premised on the idea that a competitive market is one made up of lots of competitors, by definition, many of them small. Instead, our antitrust policy is surrendered to this notion that all that really matters ultimately is efficiency and low prices, at least in the short term. Since that time, of course, we've seen this dramatic decline in small businesses. Just in the last decade, the overall market share of firms with fewer than 100 employees has fallen from 33% to 28%. Starting a new business appears to be harder than ever, although we like to imagine ourselves as this nation of startups. According to multiple data sources, as Greg and others have referenced, the number of new businesses being created each year has fallen dramatically. Meanwhile, of course, we have these stunning degrees of consolidation, and it's been particularly aggressive in sectors that have historically been really places that offered robust opportunity for entrepreneurs. I mean, retail is a really glaring example. Walmart, I think this is one of the scariest statistics in our economy. Walmart now captures one out of every $4 that Americans spend on food, on groceries. There are over 40 metro areas where Walmart's market share in the grocery sector is over 50%. And the toll that this has taken on independent retailers is significant. We've lost, there are 80,000 fewer independent retailers today than there were in 1999. And of course, Walmart's rise is having this impact all the way up the supply chain, triggering this wave of mergers among other supermarket chains and among producers and processors, as Mike talked about. We now have this food system where we have farmers on the one end and eaters on the other, and we have these small number of gatekeepers in between, and of course, more and more of the dollars of our consumer food dollars going into their pockets. We can consider another pivotal sector, which is the banking sector. In 1995, if you did like a pie graph of how the banking sector was divided up, you would have about a third of it in the hands of small community banks, about a third of it in the hands of sort of mid-sized banks, about a third of it in the hands of national banks, and then you have this little sliver of the giant banks, banks over $100 billion in assets. 1995. Fast forward to 2005. Now that giant banks, which are basically about 20 banks and really dominated by just four banks, by 2005 they're up to 41% of the market after a whole series of mergers, changes in banking regulation. Today, after the financial crisis, after everything else, that segment of the market, those 20 giant banks are now up to 59% of the market. Just remarkable. And over that same time period, we've seen startup activity in the banking sector collapse. We used to approve hundreds of new banks every year. Since 2010, regulators have approved one new bank. No longer this pipeline of new institutions starting. And the same basic story has been repeated, of course, across the economy. And there are a lot of policies that are driving those trends. It's not just antitrust, but I think our attitudes about monopoly policy, I think really form the core of how policymakers think about bigness and scale and economic policymaking. I think there's remarkably little public debate, or not nearly enough, about the merits of this path that we have been on. Public discourse, I think, seems to be enveloped in this kind of fog of assumptions about efficiency, about the scale of business. You know, big companies, we assume, deliver better outcomes. The loss of entrepreneurial activity in small business is simply a price we have to pay, right, for the evolution of the economy. That's the idea we live under. But if you really start to dig around and look, there's a lot of evidence to the contrary. Small banks and credit unions, for example, on average charge significantly lower account fees and offer better interest rates compared to giant banks. Local banks are also much better at doing what we ultimately need banks to do, which is they devote a lot more of their resources, they allocate our capital to productive lending that generates jobs rather than to speculation. And they also make much smarter lending decisions. They consistently have lower default rates on the loans that they make. And indeed, for the purposes of this symposium, small banks play an incredibly important role because they provide the lion's share of small business lending. Community banks only hold about 20% of all the banking assets, but they make 60% of all the small business loans. And the reason is that big banks are not very good at doing small business loans because they lack all that soft information. They don't know the local market. They don't know the borrower. They have very low success rates on the small business loans that they do make, so they stay out of that market. So as we've been losing community banks, we've had this incredible credit crisis for small entrepreneurs. We do an annual survey every year of about 3,000 independent businesses. This year's survey of the business who said that they had wanted to grow and had sought financing, one in three had been unable to obtain a loan. And among minority-owned businesses, it was nearly half had been unable to obtain the loan that they needed to grow. And there's a lot, you know, it's not just me. There are studies by many economists that have found that banking economies of scale top out when a bank reaches a size of about a small regional bank. Yet nearly 80% of the sector is in the hands of banks that are larger than the optimal size, according to economists, from an efficiency standpoint. Why is it then that these big banks grow? Simon Johnson, former economist at the International Monetary Fund, says a lot of it has to do with the ability to exercise political power, which, you know, as we've seen in the last few years, is enormously lucrative. It's not about competition, it's about dominating democracy. It's really hard, you know, to find other sectors. There's such a wealth of data on banks because they have to publish their balance sheets every quarter. It's hard to find other sectors where you can really look at this in a kind of case study way, but every so often we find one. One that I think is really interesting comes from the state of North Dakota. In 1961, North Dakota passed a law that bans corporations from owning pharmacies. So in order to own a pharmacy in North Dakota, you have to be a pharmacist. There are no chain pharmacies. There's no CVS, there's no Rite Aid, there's no Walgreens, there's no Walmart pharmacy, Target pharmacy, and so on. It's all independent pharmacies. So it's, you know, if you look at North Dakota, which we did last year, the Institute for Local Self-Reliance, we published a report on the state's pharmacy sector. You know, it's a lot like the beer aisle that Craig showed us, you know. It's this diversity of businesses. In our analysis, we compared North Dakota's pharmacy sector to neighboring South Dakota and to the U.S. as a whole. It was really kind of remarkable what we found. We found that North Dakota has among the lowest prescription drug prices in the country. They have far more pharmacies per capita than neighboring states and than the U.S. as a whole. And in particular, they have pharmacies at much greater rates in very small communities. In rural areas, there's much more likely to be a pharmacy in North Dakota than in rural areas of South Dakota or anywhere else in the U.S. The result is that people have this ready access. They don't have to drive an hour to a big town. And there's also evidence that the state's pharmacies provide a higher level of health care. This really, it goes against conventional wisdom, but there it is. Maybe we're not better off with this constant consolidation. If you talk to independent pharmacies in other parts of the country, what they'll tell you is that one of their biggest problems they have is that they're at the mercy of these pharmacy benefit management companies that manage prescription drugs on behalf of insurers. Just two PBMs, as they're known, now account for 70% of the market. PBMs commonly provide a lot of incentives, like lower copays, to encourage patients to choose a mail-order pharmacy or chain. They offer these kind of take-it-or-leave-it contracts to independent pharmacies that basically block them from even being eligible to be in the insurer's network in many places. And of course, PBMs also have a financial stake in steering people away from independent pharmacies. CVS Health, for example, which is one of the big two, owns the CVS drugstore chain, and they own a mail-order pharmacy. So you can imagine how they want to rig the system in their favor. In North Dakota, it's different. Some of those dynamics, particularly with mail-order play out, are affecting that state too. But in order to provide prescription benefits to the state's residents, PBMs actually have to negotiate with independent pharmacies, and it's a bit of a level playing field in those negotiations. They have to be willing to work with them, and that's really made a huge difference, and it's made it possible for residents of North Dakota to be able to freely choose to go to an independent pharmacy. So, I think, and we've done research that goes through this in sector after sector. I think the efficiency arguments are not nearly as robust and supportable as we're often led to believe or that we imagine. But I really, as I said in the beginning, I really think that efficiency is not the end all. Even if it sometimes means paying a bit more, we're ultimately better off with a diverse economy of small enterprises where corporations don't become so big that they really overwhelm our markets and overwhelm our political system. And there's a lot of research that we and other folks have done that have looked at how much healthier places that have lots of small businesses are. There are studies that have found that communities where a larger share of the economy is in the hands of locally owned businesses, all else being equal, have seen greater growth in median incomes, lower poverty rates, less income inequality, and also they score a lot better on measures of social health. They vote more, there's more civic participation. There's a lot of reasons that I think that our approach to competition policy ought to think about democracy and ought to think about a diverse economy really at its center. Antitrust policy is on the minds of independent business owners to a degree that I think would probably surprise many of you. It certainly surprised me 15 years ago when I started giving talks to small business audiences, and I've given talks to audiences of toy retailers and booksellers, innkeepers, florists, funeral directors, you name it. And invariably, one of the first questions I get is, what the hell happened to antitrust? This is the reality that they live in. From their perspective, aggressively anti-competitive behaviors on the part of big companies have become routine. You talk to folks in the retail sector and they say predatory pricing is commonplace. This is how Walmart expanded across the country. It was coming into a town, offering low prices, and then slowly raising those prices when there was no longer much in the way of competition. It's interesting that Walmart was unable to execute that strategy in Germany because they take a very different approach in terms of how they enforce antitrust, and the result was that Walmart pulled out almost immediately. Companies use their market power to manipulate the supply chain. This is something we also consistently hear from independent retailers, that their big competitors are extracting all kinds of unwarranted advantages from suppliers. It's something that comes up over and over again in our survey through pricing, different kinds of terms, promotional allowances that they're not eligible for, even at the same quantity, even in the same basic setup. But by far, I think the biggest concern on the minds of most of the small manufacturers and retailers that we work with is Amazon. Amazon is now the 10th largest retailer in the country. It's doubling in size every 2 to 3 years. Amazon now accounts for 1 out of every 3 items that Americans buy online, and it's actually growing faster than e-commerce as a whole, meaning its share, of course, of that market is getting bigger and bigger. Amazon has 50% of the market for books, both print and digital, and as we have seen repeatedly over the last few years, they have the ability to cripple any publisher simply by removing the buy button from that publisher's titles. Amazon's dealt with its rival e-commerce companies like diapers.com by selling diapers below cost and then going in and buying diapers.com for a song. And they've done it with Zappos, they've done it, they own all of these internet brands now. Amazon has emerged as a kind of modern-day railroad in a way as well. It's a platform that many companies have to use now to get to market. One of the things that's happened in online shopping is that consumers are no longer going to a search engine to start their shopping process. They're just going to Amazon. And so a lot of small companies, even companies that had actually made a very successful business of online commerce, are no longer getting traffic, and they've had to surrender and become third-party sellers on Amazon. About a third of all the business Amazon does is through these third parties that sell on its platform. And of course, that is a very dangerous relationship. Amazon owns all of your customer information. It actually owns and has access to the most important thing you as a retailer have, which is your ability to curate, to discern which products are going to be hot sellers. Now Amazon can see that. And it's very easy for them to say, look, you're selling a whole bunch of this thing. I'm going to bring it into my own inventory, and I'm going to price it the way that I want to, below your price, and you have no choice. I can actually price it because I control your margin effectively. I can price it in a way that you can no longer make any money off of it. So it's a perilous path to go, but this is what many online retailers, and indeed many brick and mortar retailers who've had to get into online commerce, are now faced with. They have to join up and use, as I said, this modern day railroad. A few years ago, I did this piece of work for the American Specialty Toy Association, which is both retailers and manufacturers on e-commerce and on Amazon. And it really became apparent that Amazon is poised to, or is already in the process of, destroying a lot of value and innovation in our economy. One of the things, I interviewed a lot of small specialty toy manufacturers. This is pretty much everybody but Hasbro and Mattel. And one of the things that I learned is that they have found through their own research that about 3/4 of new product discovery, when they introduce a new product, how it gets discovered, how consumers learn about it, happens in brick and mortar stores, and in particular, independent brick and mortar stores. But the question is, how do you, what often happens is that the consumer discovers that product in a local store, but then buys it online, buys it from Amazon, often at a cheaper price. And so the big question they're sort of frantically trying to figure out is, how do we control who's selling our product and at what is the ultimate retail price? How do we build in and ensure that there's a margin that represents the enormous value that brick and mortar retailers deliver in terms of marketing and showcasing and introducing and helping consumers learn about all of our new products, that engine that drives innovation and drives these specialty toy companies? They feel the legal issues around resale price maintenance and minimum advertised pricing aren't clearly supportive of their position. Many of them sell through distributors, so they can't ultimately control who ends up selling their product. I talked to one manufacturer, very successful line of toys in a lot of ways, very popular with independent retailers. One of his most successful toys had gotten picked up right in the middle of the holiday season by some third-party retailer on Amazon who decided to dump large quantities of it on the market at about an 80% discount. He nearly went under because not only because all of his brick-and-mortar suppliers started returning this product in droves because they couldn't sell it, and they became very frustrated and didn't want to carry his other stuff as well. He had no control over this and no real way to protect his company or his brand in this market. So far, to all of these independent retailers and manufacturers' astonishment, the only intervention with regard to Amazon that the Department of Justice has taken has to bolster Amazon's position in the marketplace and to make producer set pricing feel even more questionable and uncertain. I think one of the things that I heard one of these manufacturers say when I was doing this research that really stuck with me is, he's like, you don't even know when these small manufacturing companies disappear because they no longer have a retail market, or they can no longer deal with these enormous companies that they're selling to, is you don't even know what you're missing. I mean, and that's part of the problem with where we have gotten with entrepreneurship. It's like you don't even know what products didn't get developed, get designed. We don't know what we're losing. You know, we don't know what books are not getting published. We don't know what innovative toys aren't being made. And so it's hard to really judge what it is that we've given up, because we don't actually see it. So for all these reasons, I think it's high time that we really rethink monopoly policy, and that we put entrepreneurship and robust competition among lots of competitors really back as the central goal of what it is that we're trying to achieve. So thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Stacy, and all of our three panelists for their talks today. Our goal was to set the stage for a conversation that will take place throughout the day by presenting, in effect, a number of different case studies of entrepreneurship, and to also describe the linkages between a level playing field in terms of competition policy and the outcomes that are generated for entrepreneurship as well as a result of entrepreneurship. So with that, we've eaten a little bit of time into our break. We'll catch up. Let's take a short break, and then we'll bring in our second panel. Thank you very much.